Thank you. Thank you, madam. If I chose to present myself, I wouldn't be able to present myself the way you did. Thank you very much. In the name of God, the most merciful, most compassionate, I start, peace be upon you. Dear brother, Dr. Jamal Sanad Suwaidi, the Director General of the Emirates Center for Strategic Studies and Research. Dear participants, ladies and gentlemen, Assalamu alaikum, peace be upon you. Actually, it's an honor to be here with you this evening and to take part and contribute, though modestly, to enriching the dialogue and discussion. Hopefully, you will find me an active member in the celebrations of the center on the 20th anniversary of its establishment. Actually, I do consider the center as my second home, if not the first. Like those who have two houses, two lives, two wives. However, actually, I am not the one to be asked about this center because I am very optimistic regarding its establishment and the very idea behind its establishment. The idea has developed with support from His Highness Sheikh Mohammed bin Zayed from a small center in a flat that you would hardly be able to find it. And you have to go through a dusty pavement until you reach. Now it becomes this complex that's really great. This is so it's a hypermarket. It is not in the fact that it is really big building, but in the products, its role has become an iconic example of the achievements of the United Arab Emirates, the Emirate of Abu Dhabi, and the GCC in the Arab world at large. I would like to thank those in charge of this center. Specifically, I would like to address my thanks to Abu Khalid, His Highness Sheikh Mohammed bin Zayed, and His Highness His Excellency Dr. Jamal Al-Suwaidi. I would like to congratulate us all for having this center. I would like to thank all those who are the known and the unknown soldiers working in this center. Thank you all for all the activities and events you organize. And I would like to congratulate you on the 20th anniversary. Don't forget to invite us for the 50th anniversary, even if we were not here. But pray for us if we are already on the earth. For three decades, the history has registered in this city a distinctive moment, an important one, with the establishment of the GCC. The participants has adopted a Gulf package. It is the idea of developing one Gulf that starts from Kuwait in the north and ends up in Oman in the south. The question to be asked this evening, what have these countries done? What has this union done in order to manifest the dream and to bring it to reality? Can we say that the regional events have made this dream just nothing in a desert? Let me take you in this important center with the presence of those participants of different specializations to discuss this idea of a GCC. It is an attempt to answer some of these questions and to discuss what been achieved and where are the shortcomings, where those misunderstood points. I would like to tell you from the very first moment that this is only a brainstorming that I would like to invite you to take part in order to broaden it. On the 25th of May 1981, and in this very capital, and with the attendance of the heads of six Gulf states at the time, the United Arab Emirates, the Kingdom of Bahrain, the State of Kuwait, the State of Qatar, the Kingdom of Saudi Arabia, the Sultanate of Oman, they all declared the new Arab association, which is the GCC, with the presence of the Secretary General of the Arab League and the Secretary General of the Islamic Conference Organization. This was the culmination of lots of visits and studies during the 60s, the 70s, and the 80s of the 20th century in order to go for a full unity. However, these attempts were not as fruitful as it was wished to be, and this is why there was a hastening decision to declare the GCC. There were several elements that led to what we have. First of all, the success of the Iranian Revolution in 1979 and the noise of the revolutionary slogans to export the revolution to the neighboring countries and all the threats addressed to the Shah of Iran at the time. Second, the communist Russian invasion of Afghanistan in 1979 and the American intervention and the money from the Gulf to support the Mujahideen in Afghanistan. Third, the Iraqi-Iranian war in 1986 that were on for 8 years with support from the idea was to support Saddam Hussein with the fear that Iran would invade the Arab countries. Fourth, the split in the Arab countries regarding the support to the Iraqi president at this time, Saddam Hussein, and the fear of the sectarian divisions. And fifth, the turbulence on the borders between Oman and South Yemen as a result of the reflection of the revolution and the attempts to expand communism through the southern gate of the Arab Peninsula. Despite all these difficult circumstances that dictated a new reality to the conservative political role of the Gulf politics, and despite the fact that those countries understand the Arab development, the GCC, those countries attempted to understand the circumstances of the Gulf, its realities and its elements, and the indication to that is that the present Prince of Kuwait, the Foreign Minister of Kuwait at the time, was envoyed to Russia, and Kuwait was at the time the only country that sustained good relationship with the USSR in order to discuss the issues related to axes and to explain to the USSR that the GCC is not like Baghdad Pact. It is a culmination of the efforts of the brothers in order to stay away from any sort of polarity and to be on the side of the United Nations, the Arab League, and to be in line with the development on both the regional and international arenas, and to shoulder the responsibility towards the Arab and Muslim peoples. The GCC, which is the new, the newly born baby that aims at getting the coordination and integration between countries of similar their political systems in different political, military, security, and economic fields. The GCC acts as a shield against the threats from the region, because you know that the regional blocs are usually bringing together two or three countries in order to have permanent establishments that have a legal status, and those pacts usually have inter-regional and national alliances. In order to discuss the objectives behind the establishment of the GCC, we will see the following. First, the establishment of the Common Defense Council. Second, the one currency, the freedom of movement amongst the borders, the unification of the textbooks in all government schools, and the establishment of the shield of the peninsula, and also the endeavor to have the Arab, the Gulf unified currency. And sixth is the objective of joining the Arab pacts in different forms. I mean, we know that there were several factors that played a role on the local, regional, and international levels when the national issues were raised during the 70s and 80s and 90s, and been a force for strengthening this council and for its sustainability. However, the events of the 11th of September played a negative role and undermined the axes of cooperation amongst the different countries. And within that prospect, I would mention the following. First of all, the expansion of the American role in the region and establishment of permanent American military bases. This is why the decisions of the countries of the Council is linked to the American Foreign Ministry, whereas the those countries were endeavoring before that to play an independent role. Second, the border conflicts between the countries of the region. Third, the attempts of some countries in the Council to play a greater role in the international and regional fields. Fourth, the impact of the Arab Spring on the foreign policies of the countries member of the Council. Fifth, not the failure to unify all the governmental structures in the countries of the Council. And there was a change in the type of international alliances. And we'll see that the GCC countries are approaching unprecedented changes that require unified policies. Of course, it is still a dream to have the Gulf unity and to develop the GCC. However, we, as peoples of the country and the leaders of these countries, have to be up to the level of shouldering the responsibilities at the times that we have in these countries. Let me tell you about some urgent issues. I mean, this is the organizational structure of the Council, the Supreme Council, the Ministerial Council, the General Secretariat, the Secretary General, 11 Assistant Secretary General, the Consultancy Authority, the Strategic Dialogue Negotiation. This is not activated up till the present time. This is a table of some facts about the member states of the GCC, and also some statistics from the neighboring countries. First of all, the expansion of the local people's base, and to organize fair elections that bring together men, women, and all sects in order to join the political process. Second, the need to involve the civil society forces and the new cooperation amongst the economic, academia, and cultural elites in the countries of the Council in order to have cross-countries groups and also the respect of the specificities of each country in the Council. Third, the countries of the Council should play a dynamic role in achieving regional coexistence, and this requires a cumulative style and bilateral efforts as well as a collective behavior, officially and unofficially, in order to develop a new pattern in which the countries play a role based on the cooperation. Fourth, to work in order to have pan-Gulf institutions and to develop Al Jazeera shield into an active force. And the recommendations of Sultan Qaboos in 1992 are an example of the need for the unified Gulf army and to have more economic integration amongst the member states and the activation of the efforts in order to have the monetary union, in order to have a one currency and full citizenship and a pan-Gulf common market. Also to work in order to have peaceful regional coexistence through coordination and cooperation with the neighboring countries, Yemen, Iraq, and Iran. Fifth, the GCC should work to act wisely with the expectations of an American-Iranian agreement and also with the Arab coexistence through activation of the institutions of the Arab League that are impotent so far. Six, the GCC countries should work in order to have a security system that have peaceful coexistence, because the peoples of the region cannot continue to have welfare unless there is a sound economic development, but this cannot be achieved without peaceful military coexistence. Seventh, the activation of the role of the consultory or council of the council in order to become a base that, or a database that can provide the council with all the studies needed, with the specializations, and to have it as a starting point for a unified parliament, Gulf parliament. The Council should have an integration role in the field of powers, energy, renewable energy, and clean energy, especially considering the role of the Gulf states in the exportation of oil, and not to depend solely on the exports of oil. We should invest in atomic energy and also solar energy and the shale gas energy. Ninth, the need to have a unified Gulf Center for security, economic, and energy security studies in order to present recommendations to the decision makers in the GCC countries. And this should include specialized studies for Iraq, Yemen, and Iran. And we are really happy and lucky that we have the Emirates Center for Strategic Studies and Research, because it is maybe the only center that discusses the security, economic, and political studies. In other countries, in Yemen, in Iraq, and in Iran, there are many strategic centers, but we do not have the like. So it's high time to consider long term and to make use of these centers as centers for research and for following up the issues I mentioned in the countries of the Gulf states. The 21st century is the century of alliances through the development of political alliances and economic markets. This is why the stability of our neighborhood, Iraq, Yemen, and Iran, would enhance the opportunities for the stability of the region and would push forward development on different levels. From that perspective, we should integrate those countries in an integrated, comprehensive regional system, because this is again for the Gulf system. This can be achieved through, first, the establishment of a Gulf Health Line actively and quickly in order to attend to the hotspots and difficult problems in the world and in the Arab world. Second, the encouragement of the establishment of a Gulf Forum that brings together intellectuals, politicians, economists from the Gulf states and from the neighboring countries with official support in order to discuss all issues of mutual interest. Third, the establishment of the Gulf Charter, similar to the Helsinki Charter between the countries in the Gulf and the neighboring countries, and to have an announcement, declaration of principles in order to build the Gulf regional system that would organize the relationship between these countries on the basis of peaceful cooperation. Fourth, we should study how to deal with the Gulf security through adopting the theory of inclusion and not exclusion nor confrontation as a long-term objective in order to bring together the Gulf states with the neighboring countries in order to have common objectives. Is this a warning or this is the end? It is clear that the GCC countries have not been affected, or let's say that it is the least affected by the Arab Spring because of their specificity and the gigantic financial resources available to them. Actually, this Gulf linkages make those countries distinctive from other Arab countries, and these unities of the relationships between the Gulf relations that strengthen these closeness. We need to study all the contradictions and the differences between the members of the GCC in an innovative and realistic way. The special relationship of each member in the GCC can contribute to the overall relationships of the group, and it can also give some sort of freedom and flexibility in dealing with others, and this is a positive power. Also, to understand the peaceful opposition to act violently against this opposition is not a wise attitude. We should study this with long-term objectives in mind and not on the basis of short-term competitiveness. There is competition from Russia and from China, and we need to understand as Gulf states we should really deal with those countries, and any Gulf conflict regarding the security agreement and the withdrawal of ambassadors can create a fuss in the media and unfruitful debates, and these debates are an indication of the supremacy of the narrow national interests over the regional interests. We have to really reconsider our positions and look with lots of objectiveness to our common interests. We should go back to the questions I started this presentation with. Is the dream of having a unity, a union, a confederation, a one state, still possible in light of the internal circumstances and the external challenges? The answer, that is really the wish of the majority of the peoples of the GCC, is yes, there is a people's will and willingness to cooperate within Confederation. Moreover, it is to have one political regime. We need political regimes that are capable of acting according to the people's wish, and this requires patience and an overcome of all the small issues in interest of the supreme issues. We need a developmental revival in the Gulf states that would really raise the awareness of the people in the GCC of the importance of having one political pact. And we have an example in the United Arab Emirates, having a one country comprised after being seven emirates. I pray to God that would help us to manifest the dream of our fathers and to bring it to reality. And the countries of this council in the past 50 years acted in a way that might take 500 years for other countries, and they could now play this prominent role in the Arab political system. We still dream, however, of contributing to developing the human values. And worth mentioning in this regard, this Gulf presence in the crises and disasters on both the Arab and international levels. Syria, for example, altogether, we as researchers and media people, as ordinary people, we have to seek means and ways to manifest the dream of our fathers and to make it a reality, and or to have one unified Gulf state that is really promising. Thank you very much. I would like to thank Dr. Abdel Rida Asiri. It's true that you cut short the last part of your presentation. Maybe I was a bit authoritative in asking you to finish your presentation. Thank you. I open the floor now for questions and discussion. We have time. Let's say that we have a 30-minute for discussions. Kindly present yourself and where you work, and be brief in order to give the floor to the largest number possible of interventions. In the name of God, Dr. Fawzi Hassan, Al-Manzar Center for Strategic Studies in Dubai. Thank you, Dr. Abdel Rida, and I would like also to thank the Emirates Center for inviting us to attend this important series of lectures we are immensely in need of in the GCC countries. I have one remark. The presentation was a bit ideal more than realistic, especially when tackling the Gulf problems and conflicts. I mean, the question you asked, is the unity still a possibility or not? I think it's not in the present circumstances. However, it is not impossible. It might be possible between two countries, for example, Saudi Arabia and Emirates, but amongst the six countries, it's not possible. But however, it's not possible. it's not impossible, I mean, because of some internal circumstances and some external circumstances, including the fluctuation of the foreign policy of the United States towards the Gulf countries, and also the impact of the Arab Spring, and that caused lots of conflicts between the Gulf countries in their attitude towards what's happening in other parts of the Arab world. So I hoped that you would talk about the zero problem policy for the Gulf states, so we can have confidence again and we can have a conducive environment in order to have a unity. This is with my reservation on the stance of the countries that have reservation on the unity recently. Thank you very much, Dr. Khalid Omar. Thank you, Doctor. Actually, we enjoyed listening to you. For me, when I read the title, the GCC 30 years after the establishment, I do not care, is it pessimism or optimism, because three decades are good. Any criticism is meaningless, because this is an existing, ongoing system that lasts for 30 years. However, I have some questions. Is there a unified Gulf policy, with the exception of the declarations that are issued by the end of the GCC summits? Second, to what extent the GCC countries will remain away from the change taking place in the rest of the Arab region and the world at large? Third, the Arab came from the Arab Peninsula and went to the whole world to build civilizations in Baghdad, Damascus, and Andalusia. Isn't it high time now, after three decades of GCC, to consider an Arab role beyond this limited Gulf system? Taysir Sleiman, thank you very much for this presentation. The GCC is the pride of all Arabs and Muslims. It should be developed and increasing those ties for the best interest of our people. My question, after 33 years of the Islamic revolution in Iran, what are the risks, if any, represented by Iran against GCC countries? My second question, is it possible to have a one Gulf delegation to go and get into a dialogue in Iran in order to find solutions to all existing issues between Iran and the GCC countries? The question asked by Fauzi regarding the Gulf dream, which is not and not impossible. As you said, it is not impossible, but as you mentioned, the present circumstances maybe make it difficult for six Gulf states that have similarities in many issues and have differences on many issues to integrate in any way possible, whether as a union, a confederation, or as one state. However, it remains as a long-term dream. However, it doesn't mean that it is not possible. As you mentioned, it is the best tactic for now is to have some sort of unity on a bilateral level between two countries, for example, that have lots of similarities, and maybe another two countries would follow suit, and so on and so forth, until we reach a union. And I think this is a sort of a solution for the inability to reach a union or a confederation, because there are many differences. And these are some prominent differences. And this would lead me to the answer to the second question, the strategy of Gulf-Gulf cooperation. It's been a practice now when countries deal with each other is to have the official institutions cooperating, whether on the level of heads of states, cabinets, parliaments, and so on and so forth. And this is the case in the Gulf states, but there is also the individual and the people's relationships, because we have we are families here in the Gulf states, and we can really bring together even the leaderships and the officials, so we can also act together not only through the political official institutions, but through the people. I think what happened recently, the withdrawal of the three countries' ambassadors from the state of Qatar, was an unprecedented event to see those conflicts and differences seen, and of course to see those conditions now in order to settle those differences means that we are facing a new phase, and maybe the personal relationships are no longer of impact. I think when those differences appear, it means that there is a sort of a threat, blackmail, and provocation. And that wasn't the case between the countries of the GCC. This is a new phenomena in the Gulf relationship, Gulf states relationships. As for your question, Dr. Khaled, what about a unified foreign policy? I mean, I think even in the European Union, when there is the external relation commissioner, however, each of the European countries still has its foreign relationships and policy. However, they coordinate their policies sometimes. I think the members of the GCC do have some stance in the negotiation, for example, with the EU, with China, and with India. They deal with those issues collectively. And this is an indicator of a sort of a start for unified or common foreign policies. This, however, can be a reflection of the internal circumstances. There are differences. This is why we do not have this common foreign policy. I couldn't understand your question, actually. I didn't hear it well. Could you repeat it, please? Since there are means of communication, we know that the Gulf states have capabilities. What we saw in Oman, in Bahrain, and in some other areas, this is an indication that it will that those pressures would reach the younger generation. Now the financial capacities and the social relationships in the GCC states are capable of embodying and dealing with those pressures. However, 10 years from now, 20 years from now, we will see that those pressures will become greater. I mean, the very nature of the regimes in the Gulf states and the nature of the relationship between the people and the governor or the prince does not exist in the same way as it is in the other Arab countries. This makes the Gulf states capable of overcoming problems now. As for your third question regarding a role on the level of the Arab level, I'm pretty sure that we are born with the dream of one Arab country from the Gulf to the ocean. And we were brought up with this idea of Arab unity. However, the idea has changed now. Now there is this specificity. Maybe the GCC is the closest possible to getting together. However, unfortunately, I would say that this idea of unity has come to an end, unfortunately. I would like to say expired. If you remember in the 50s, 60s, and the 70s, there was the idea of popularism. I mean, we should go back to our specific commonalities. Arabism and populism, unfortunately, have proved to be not possible. I recall a few weeks ago, we had here the Secretary General of the Arab League, and we heard him talking about the difficulties the Arab League facing. Dr. Taysir, you asked about the risks imposed by Iran against the GCC countries. 2 or 3 days ago, the Prince of Kuwait visited Iran, and we all hope that this is going an indication of a Gulf understanding rather than a Kuwaiti-Iranian understanding, especially when we see now that the Arab League and the GCC are working together. Iran looks at itself as a major power in the region, and it looks with different eye to the others. And this does not mean that Iran does not endeavor to settle some sort of normal relationships with the GCC, but it sees itself as the greatest nation, the greatest state, the state with a civilization, and it wants to impose this idea and to achieve its dreams against the GCC. This does not mean that we boycott Iran, because ultimately we have our ties with Iran geographically, on a religious basis, on a social level. We need stability in the region. We need Iran, and Iran needs us. We need dialogue and communication, not only on the official level, but on the semi-official level, with the NGOs, with the civil society, with the associations. This will bring us closer. But it does not mean that Iran, as a major state in the region, does not have objectives and visions regarding its foreign policy. Dr. Mustafa Tahir, the decision-making support center, the Ministry of Interior. My question is related to the foreign policy question and what you mentioned recently regarding the Iranian role. I ask from the perspective of really being an Egyptian who likes the Gulf states, especially the Emirates. I'm sorry. My question, isn't it high time that the GCC countries formulate one negotiating power in dealing with others in two fields in particular? First, in the negotiation with Iran, there are rights for the Gulf states with Iran, and some lost rights, and it is difficult to gain back those rights unless the states in the Gulf joined efforts and negotiate collectively. Second, the military level and field. When you negotiate with manufacturing companies, isn't it better for the states in the Gulf to negotiate to buy arms collectively? Wouldn't that give them the benefit of this collective bargaining? Thank you. In the name of God, I start, Dr. Abdel Raza. Thank you very much, and thank you for this presentation. Actually, when I look at the title of your presentation, to describe this Gulf relationship, I feel that it is the weakest. Why they've chosen GCC? This. Why it's not a union, why it's not a unity, why it's not an alliance or any other form of cooperation that makes it stronger. The second point, the title of your presentation, the GCC 33 years after establishment. When you mention the age of any entity, we recall what has been achieved during those years. For example, if you talk about a person who is 33 years old, I'm Khaled Abedat, a retired person from Jordan. If he is a military person, we talk about what has he achieved over the 33 years of its age. If he is, for example, a military, so we ask about the workshops, about the training he obtained. If he is studying, we ask about the diplomas and certificate he could obtain. Recently, Jordan and Morocco were invited to join the GCC, and as a military person with a military background, I started to think and analyze what are the reasons that would make the GCC invite Jordan and Morocco. These are two countries outside the region of the Council, are invited to join the Council. And from my readings of Gulf and Jordanian references, I couldn't find any big strategic issues that would call upon us to have those two countries joining the Council. And suddenly, this idea came to an end, and we couldn't understand what was the reason behind the invitation and what are the reasons behind cancelling the whole idea altogether. Ahmed Shbib al-Zahiri, a previous member in the advisory council. Thank you. Working in the Gulf Advisory Authority gave me the possibility to see that the Gulf states are looking for the civil state. I'm really happy with what you mentioned, such as the Gulf Forum and the Gulf Charter. How can we call for that when we have countries that are not endeavoring? We usually ask for those pacts, for example, when the states are calling for some sort of exporting a revolution rather than building a civil state as we endeavor to have. Assalamu alaikum. Ali Al-Ammari from the Emirates Center for Strategic Studies. I would like to thank you for the valuable presentation. There is a discussion on the emergence of an active Gulf role in leading the Arab world. What sort of method that would make it possible for such leading role? The last question. Assalamu alaikum. Dr. Sultana Amri, thank you for the presentation. You mentioned regional, unified regional system. And Iran has always endeavored to talk about this and to have the security of the Gulf states provided by the countries in the region. And the minister of foreign minister of Iran talked about Rouhani's initiative to have a unified security regional system. You also mentioned this this superiority attitude of Iran, looking at itself as a superpower in the region. How can we make Iran look more realistically? I agree with my colleague who started his question by expressing his emotions to the Gulf states and to the Emirates. We have the same feeling. We do not only like Egypt, we love Egypt, and congratulations, and God be with Egypt and grant it its stability, because the stability of Egypt is the stability of the Arab world and the stability of the Middle East. Egypt is a central state and cannot be overlooked. And at the same time, Iran is a central state and cannot be overlooked, whether we like it or not. This is the reality. Of course, you know all the prerequisites for a big regional state, powerful state, are all provided in both Iran and Egypt and cannot be overlooked. You talked about the collective negotiation. Of course, when you negotiate collectively as five or six countries, and this reminds me of a story in 1958. There was the unity between Syria and Egypt. Do you recall that? Were you there at the time? We celebrated that when I was in elementary school. We had one stick, and the teacher asked us to try and break it, and we could, but when they brought two together, we were asked to break them, and nobody could. And this is the traditional story we keep saying about the power of unity. But as I mentioned, every country has a vision, a philosophy, and interest. They can agree on certain issues and disagree on many issues. Not having this collective negotiation power, especially in the purchases of weapons, because with this you do not have political relationship, military, strategic, and financial interest are all getting together in the purchases of arms for states and for the different institutions. This is why they cannot be negotiated collectively. If the countries in the GCC agree on buying particular weapons for this country or for that country, whether fighters or others, I think maybe our defense position could have been better. But as I mentioned, in 1992, Sultan Qaboos was requested to present a military report, and he did so, discussing a unified Gulf army of 100,000 soldiers, but this did not happen. So I do not disagree with you at all regarding the importance of the collective negotiation power, whether to negotiate with Iran or with any other country or power. Once again, I would like to tell you that we love Egypt. As for the question regarding GCC choosing the weakest forms of unity. It's not an alliance, it's not a union, it's not a confederation. Now, 33 years, three decades, more than one generation, and we can say that the GCC still exists. It doesn't develop into an alliance or a union. However, there are certain issues that highlighted the unity of the people. For example, in the Iraqi invasion of Kuwait in 1990, there was a picture of unity, of alliance, of pact in facing that invasion. That was a success story of the Gulf states facing an aggression against a member state. So this is a success story, and this is what you can call an alliance, a one country, a union, a political, a military, a social and economic union. What has the Council achieved? I think it is one of three other Arab entities that were born 50 years ago still exist. For example, the Maghreb Cooperation Council almost does not exist. The Arab League, the only successful entity is the GCC, and it is more successful than the Arab League. Despite all difficulties, obstacles, challenges, internal and the differences, conflicts and external challenges, the GCC continues. It still holds summit. The 33rd summit was held in Kuwait, which means that every year they come together at the level of the summit. And also, there was the 133 meetings of the council, which means that there is some sort of dynamism and a will for development. However, ultimately, as a third world countries, the change comes gradually and takes long time. However, the continuity of the Council is an indicator of success. The last question, why Jordan and Morocco were invited to join the GCC? You know, and I know, and everybody here knows that the reason behind the invitation was a political one, in light of the repercussions of the Arab Spring. The eight kingdoms in the Arab region had to come together to cooperate. Six Arab Gulf states are there in the region. There are only two kingdoms outside the region, Morocco and Jordan. Jordan is of geographical proximity, and Morocco is far away, but we do have some similarities. The reactions of some politicians and some people were against such orientation, because in its charter, the GCC did not open its membership only for those six countries, founding countries. And those countries agree on many issues. Jordan might be close, but there are many differences. The people's reaction, the public opinion, I think, was against. This is why this political dream was replaced by some sort of financial economic support those two kingdoms with the Gulf money, in order to help them face the challenges, especially the challenges dictated by the Arab Spring. Inviting Jordan and Morocco to the GCC would mean changing the nature of the GCC. It would become an Arab Gulf Cooperation Council. And there is a fund now to support those countries, supported by four Gulf states at least. The question of Ahmed regarding the Gulf Charter. I'm glad that one of the members of the advisory council is with us and discussing this issue. I do hope that this advisory council would develop into a parliament, a Gulf parliament. I think you are 30 members, right? And you have a short term in office, and you have this advisory nature. You could really investigate several issues. However, we really want, we do not want a soft advisory council, but an advisory council with a full legislative mandate, and maybe at a later stage representation with elections. So it can be a Shura council and then develops into a parliament. As for the Gulf Charter, especially with the neighbors, Iraq, Iran, Yemen, they all have their own ideology, political and military problems. It's true that dealing with them is difficult. However, you have a neighbor who causes you lots of harm day and night. You can leave your house and go and buy another house, but you cannot leave your homeland. We are here to stay, and they are there to stay. The regime is different or not different. We should deal with it from that perspective. And despite the threats, there is still a need to interact and to deal. The same happened in the case of Helsinki Pact. There was the communist and the liberal countries, the democratic and non-democratic countries. The cooperation started between the NGOs and the civil societies in those countries, and then it developed into better understanding. However, as long as we are in the same region, there is a need for stability, for security, in order to develop and really have better living conditions. There was a question by Ali. The GCC are those leading countries in the Arab world now. At a certain time in history, long time in history, the leadership was either in North Africa, in Egypt, or in the Levant, or in Mesopotamia, whether in Syria or in Iraq. The leadership now of the Arab world and is in the GCC, and the GCC, maybe the Kingdom of Saudi Arabia would be the lead in this field. This requires shouldering a responsibility towards other causes and issues. This is why we think that the members of the GCC are in prominent position in every issue, whether Arab, Islamic, or international. And the GCC countries have become the destination for many officials come to us to ask us and to take our advice. I think that the political life has shifted from the Levant, from the Nile, to the Arab Peninsula and the Gulf. The Rouhani initiative towards having a unified regional system, maybe it's not realistic, but it is an initiative anyway, and we cannot overlook. We should study it, we should follow it, at least having an initiative or something tangible that you can discuss is better than nothing. Rather than start from a scratch, you start from an initiative. This is why there is a tendency now, and maybe Rouhani initiative might be a reflection of a new tendency in Iran that might be temporary. And we saw previous initiatives such as Rafsanjani's and Khatimi. However, we say that this comes highly timely. In the end, it's my pleasure to thank. Sorry, I cannot hear the speaker. I would like to thank Dr. Abdelrada Asiri for this presentation on the GCC. I would like also to thank you all for your active attendance, and I wish that we will see you in future events organized by the Emirates Center. It is my pleasure to invite you to dinner in its new venue. Please follow the signs, the arrows, in order to reach the dinner venue. I wish you a pleasant evening. Thank you and salam alaikum. Thank you very much.